I can guarantee that at this stage in your life, there are two thoughts that are going through your mind. Number one, that you're living right in the part of your life that you used to look forward to the most when you were a kid, and it doesn't quite feel like you thought it would. And the other thing is, you thought at this stage in your life, you'd probably be settled down with someone and you'd have it all figured out. You've always had like an ideal age in your head of what age you'd like to have kids, and then you deduct how long you'd like to be with the partner before you have kids, and well, you've overshot the mark by a couple of years. First of all, let's talk about dating. The majority of men see dating wrong. Before I was a personal trainer or a best-selling author, flex, I worked in sales and marketing. I did door-to-door sales selling gas and electric, and I also was one of those annoying people in shopping centers that used to come up to you and try and sell you something. And not many people like to admit this, but sales and marketing and dating are closer aligned than you could ever imagine. The truth about sales is there's a number of conversations you need to have to make a sale. Let me give you a visual representation of this. This applies to everything in life. There is a certain amount of people you would have to speak to if you wanted to get a number. There's a certain amount of people you would have to message to get a date. And there's a certain amount of dates you'd have to go on to make love. And there were a certain amount of people you'd have to make love to find the one. And the fact of the matter is, us men are very simple creatures. And although many women don't want to hear this, there's only one thing we truly desire from the dating game. It's not just sex. For me, for the majority of my life, it was meeting someone that I wanted to have sex with more than once. So a lot of people are going to probably come at me on social media and call me a misogynist for comparing the dating world to sales. But really, it is sales and marketing. If you think about it, you have cold leads, people you're interested in that you haven't really spoken to. You have warm leads, people that you maybe expressed interest to. They know you fancy them, they fancy you, but you haven't really taken action on it. When you arrange a date or you get organized into meet, they become a prospect. And then when you close, you take a prospect to a sale. And the sale is, I'm sorry, having sex. And then a relationship is repeat business of that sale. Now, when you're looking into the renewals process of sales, the most integral important part of that is that both parties hold up their deliverables. And as long as they do that, they will keep on renewing. And what often happens in life is one of those parties stops delivering, the renewals process ends, and then you go and you look for another supplier, provider, vendor, whatever it is, and you go back on the dating market. Relationships are very much like sales and marketing. Trying to convince someone that you're trustworthy and that you should go home with them and they should date you or let you go through, it's marketing. It's marketing. And when you can appreciate that dating is a lot like marketing, you can develop a bit of a thick skin and understand that rejections are going to happen. And that maybe someone that's really good at sales might have to talk to a smaller cohort of people to get a date, and people that maybe aren't good at sales will have to talk to a larger cohort of people to get a date, which moves me on to the next part of this video. Right, number two, you need to stop drinking on dates. I'm in a good relationship now, and that wouldn't have been possible unless I stopped drinking alcohol on dates, because you would meet people on dates and straight away you look at them. I reckon it takes the human brain less than 5 seconds to determine whether or not we're into someone. And the majority of times I wouldn't be, but I've put jeans on, I've gone out, we might as well have a drink, be sociable. I've got out the house after 7 p.m. And then you sit down, you have a drink, and you're thinking, look, I'm being sociable, I'm out, I'm dating, I'm putting my hat in the ring, what can I say? Suddenly you get to the end of your first drink and you think to yourself, I could have a second. Suddenly you're coming back from the bar, you're on your third drink, and you're looking at the person you're on a date with and you're going, well, I shouldn't have judged this person so soon. That person, about an hour ago when they walked in, I wasn't so sure, but I'm feeling kind of sure now. Starting to bond, of course you are. You've just had 3 drinks and suddenly you're thinking, shouldn't judge a book by its cover. Next thing you know, you're 6 drinks in and you're thinking, well, I've come this far. It'd be a shame and a waste of the money I spent on both of our drinks to not shag them. So you shag them. Then what happens is you wake up the next day, you've got a stinking hangover on a work day because you went out on a Thursday night, and you're starting to think, what did I do? Why the hell did I do that? Oh. And suddenly you start creating a negative connotation with the idea of going out and going on dates. You think, I'm down 100 quid, I've got a stinking hangover. The idea of going on another date in the next week or the next fortnight gives me the fear. And this was my life for years on end. When it comes to dating, I can't give any better advice than be less committal. Stop giving up an entire evening to spend hours with a stranger and drink alcohol with someone. Because with alcohol, there's only a certain amount of drinks you need to go from not interested to super interested. I know it sounds cliche, but I refused to go out drinking on dates, so I started taking people for walks, to swim in the sea. I know you can't do that everywhere in the world, but maybe getting an ice cream. Just saying to someone, hey, look, I don't drink on dates anymore. Do you want to go for a walk or not? And if there's someone that won't meet you to do something without alcohol, that should be a red flag that speaks more about their position than your position. Because committing to a half-hour walk is a lot less, not just on your side, but their side. Whatever worries and anxieties you have, they have too. You're worried about wasting an entire evening and waking up with a hangover for no reason, so is she. And as long as you can sell the fact that you're not a complete weirdo, you would just much prefer to get to know her doing an activity that's more congruent with your normal daily life, she should understand. And within 20 minutes, if you're not interested in each other, you're just the dude she went for a walk with, not the guy that had 10 drinks with her on a Thursday night, ended up rooting her, wake up with a hangover and anxiety and never texted her back. Trust me, you're better off to be the guy that blanked her after an ice cream than you are the guy that blanked her after a messy one-night stand on a first date. And I know a lot of you are probably thinking, James, that doesn't sound chivalrous at all. The idea is to eradicate anxieties, but more importantly than that, to identify compatibility from the off. You only need to be with someone for a matter of minutes to know if they're truly compatible. And if they are, like two dogs sniffing each other's bums, because that's what dating is, then your second date, you arrange the drinks, the dinner, the night out. And as you're putting on your jeans and you're putting on a bit of aftershave, you're not worried with the anxiety of, I hope she's not a catfish. I hope she's not a weirdo. I hope she hasn't got a wooden leg. Nothing wrong with having a wooden leg, just some of the things that men think about. And by allocating less time and effort into dates that were never going to be right anyway, you can do them more frequently. Instead of spending £100 on a night out and getting a hangover, you could spend a tenner going for a nice ice cream, walking around Richmond Park, I don't know where you live, and you could squeeze in three of them in a week. Wouldn't be great for the waistline, but you can increase the frequency that you can find compatibility in a partner. Getting smashed once every fortnight, shagging a stranger you never talk to again, doesn't sound congruent with finding a partner for life, aka the one. Because if you can increase the frequency in which you're meeting people to determine whether or not they're compatible for you, the time it would take to go from single to finding someone who's right for you is shortened. The amount of effort, energy, time, resources you're allocating into those is now reduced. And that's only going to improve your chances of finding the wahid, which I believe is Arabic for the one. Now, the dating process sober is a lot more difficult, but guess what comes out of difficulty? Growth. You will become a better person putting yourself in uncomfortable conversations and uncomfortable situations and being a bit awkward, not having to rely on the crux of alcohol to give you the courage that you need. If you were to ask me why I think so many young men and teenagers are taking anabolic steroids, I think it's this. It's very difficult being a young man in this world. As a late teenager or early in your 20s, let's say you join the corporate world like I did or a sales department like I did, you're on a very small salary and it's very difficult to establish yourself as a person or climb the hierarchy in whatever organization as a 22-year-old old on £20,000 a year, because you're not there to be creative, you're there to do your job and to shut up. Whenever I was in my young 20s and I was trying to bring ideas to the table, everyone was like, shut up mate, you're on 20 grand a year, you haven't earned the right to contribute here. So as young men, it's incredibly difficult to build status or to build any level of decent finances because you haven't got enough experience in the world to be paid for it. And I think a lot of young men turn to steroids because then they can work on personal development in a way that they can't do in any other place. Like I said, if you're 22 and you read a couple of books and you want to put your hand up in a meeting with a brand new idea, they're going to tell you to shut up. But if you're a young person, you get on loads of gear and you stack on kilograms of muscle, suddenly you're going to be admired by other people in the gym. You're going to climb that status hierarchy with other men. You're going to be a go-to person that's going to be respected for your accomplishments in that field. From a professional sense, you cannot do that in your young 20s, but you can do it in the gym on a bit of testosterone. But if you're watching this, you're not a young man, you're in your 30s and you're starting to cry about it a little bit and going, oh, things are harder now, building muscle's harder, you can feel your testosterone slipping away from you with every single day that passes. Your sex drive, your vitality, you've got a bit fatter, you've lost a bit of muscle, I know where you're at. And you're looking at the 20-year-olds in the gym thinking, oh my God, I wish I was 20 again. All of those guys are wishing they're in their 30s, wishing they were higher up the corporate ladder and having the finances available to them to do something about it. They're looking forward to being in the part of your life you are. And this brings me on to point three, personal development and sorting your shit out. And let's be honest, the truth is you let yourself go of it. Of course you have, you're comfortable. You're getting paid more than you've ever been paid in your life. You work less hours than you've ever had to work in your life. You want to go on holiday, you can. You have the car of your dreams, although maybe on finance. You're a free man. And letting slip is just part of the process, bro. I don't need to have a PhD to understand that you probably ought to go through some kind of compositional change. Good news is, these are the only two changes that you're gonna need. First thing you're gonna wanna do is lose a bit of fat. Fat is just stored energy for later use. And the only way you can store fat is through overconsuming the amount of calories you need on a daily basis. I'm not gonna make this into some kind of scientific lesson. Your little project that you're about to embark on to find the woman of your dreams, let's save gaining this for when that's done. Here's one, intermittent fast until you find love. Here's one, no drinking alcohol and intermittent fast until you find love. Here's one, intermittent fasting, no drinking, gym 5 times a week until you find love. Let's lose the fat that you have on your body because she's not even gonna be that worried about it, but you are. The way you talk, the way you dress, the way you act is all gonna be negated if you have an issue with the amount of fat you have. Losing it is only gonna boost your vitality, your energy, your sex drive, all of these things. And the beautiful thing is, this can be done pretty soon. Then we're gonna start building muscle. We're gonna start building muscle in the process of losing fat, but once you've lost the fat, you can eat more. Because you don't need to be in a deficit anymore. You can train at maintenance. And then over the next 10, 20, 30, or probably 40 years, you can try and build as much of this as possible. You want to know the benefits of muscle? You can be strong, you can feel better about yourself. You can protect your joints, injury. More importantly, she's gonna find it sexy. Even if you're not the leanest guy in the world or you're not the most muscular guy in the world, you know what muscle says to a woman? I care, I give a shit. And I'm willing to do things over a long period of time properly because I know the benefits in the long term. Do you know what that screams like? Someone who's long-sighted and can make a good partner in life when you come to bringing up a family further down the line. The more you respect yourself and make long-term decisions, that's going to equate to their long-term thinking when it comes to bringing up a family. They're all things that go through a woman's mind when she's picking a selective mate. You're a bit of a fat mess. She's going to go, this guy doesn't really care. If he doesn't care about himself, how can I put faith in him to give a shit about a family in 10 years? Now I'm going to take you on to the most important topic of this entire video. You got to stop wanking. You have. And I'm not saying that you can never drink again or you can never wank again. I'm just saying you got to stop wanking in the meantime, because I know that you're trying hard to put yourself out there. And I also know that you're on your desktop, 3 p.m. comes around, you're thinking of locking in a date for tonight, and then suddenly you get a little tingle in your penis under the desk. So you think, I'll just have a little wank. And then part of your brain goes, don't have a wank. You're going on a date later tonight. And you go, I'm a stallion, I'm a man. I can recharge in the next 3 hours and be ready to go for a date. But the truth is, you just won't be. You're in your 30s now, bro. That recharge takes like a day, at least. And how many dates have you canceled in the past few months because you thought you were man enough to bash one out and to get the full recharge? And I know, even before you decided to have the wank, you actually thought, wouldn't it be a good idea for me to turn up to a date with an empty sack? Because then I could have a clear-headed mindset surrounding the whole thing. And if she says to you, I'm not sleeping with you tonight, because you had a wank 3 hours earlier, you would actually go, good, because I didn't want to sleep with you on the first date anyway. But what happened? Let's be honest. What happened was you thought you could give yourself post-nut clarity before the date to ensure you wouldn't be too disheartened if she didn't put out on the first date. And the truth is that the second you ejaculated, one, you looked at the genre of porn you were watching and went, wow, that's disgusting. Two, you went, wow, that's disgusting, that's someone's daughter. And three, you ended up going for a shower, washing your dick, ordering Chinese food on takeaway and sitting in that evening playing Call of Duty Warzone with the new Vondel map, didn't you? I know what us men are like, and for the last 10 years, you've probably been telling your friends so much that you just want to go out and get laid that you've started to believe it yourself. But the truth is, every man, irrespective of his place in the world, will quit the game for the right woman, and I think you would too. And the only thing worse than feeling the way you do in your 30s is the thought of being the same way in your 40s. So we've spoken about some things in this video. Treat dating like sales and marketing. Two, stop drinking on dates. Three, sort yourself out physically. Four, stop wanking. Now I know you're about to take these action steps and put them into action. You're probably wondering, how difficult can it be to really lose a pound of body fat? But I've put all the answers you need to understand that in more detail so you don't make the mistakes that everyone does when they diet, and how to lose it with a minimal effort and to get the best returns. But I'll leave that for this video. Thanks for watching.